So the way that Jim Henson is usually discussed, typically, it's I think pretty typical of great American figures. We like to believe that he was such an interesting and special individual that the forces of history had no effect on making his career what it was. Everything about his work, we like to assume, just came from his genius. And while Henson was obviously a unique person and very, very much a creative genius, very, very much so, I've devoted far too much of my life focusing on that genius, I think it's the obligation of academic institutions, or at least the ones offering a program in film studies like this one, to try to contextualize the genius with the changes in technology and distribution and economics and changes in society that played a part in making Henson's work what it is. So we're going to try to use this conversation here between three people to generate some, hopefully somewhat cohesive perspective on Henson that you don't normally get to hear, a more academic perspective. Now, with that said, we've got just the right person here to do that. Well, just the right people here to do that, but I was going to make it a segue specifically to Brian Reel, who has actually been teaching a course on Jim Henson, which is, well, very, very similar to what we're doing. I hope you don't think we're plagiarizing you.
That's
Brian.
Fine.
Would you like to tell us about what about yourself and what you do with the course?
Yeah, so let's start by talking about me.
That's a good place to start.
I'm Brian Reel. I did a PhD here at University of Maryland in what they call information studies, but it's basically libraries and archives. And I have a background in both public libraries and, much more relevantly, film archives. And while I was here at Maryland, I worked for the film studies program before it existed, actually, for a group of faculty who helped to start it and did a lot of the support work for that, a lot of the event planning and so forth. So I used to arrange things like this.
And probably arrange them much better.
Nah, this is fine. You'd be surprised at that. And I have a background in media economics and media history as well, which helps with a lot of the archives work, which helps with contextualizing film. So we've had the Jim Henson statue for years. It was put up, I think, right after I finished my undergrad. He's our most famous graduate. There might be others who are more impactful, but not as fun. And as we're starting up the program, and I'm starting to get offered opportunities to teach at different times, you know, especially during summer and winter, it's like, what do you want to propose teaching? And it's a choice of, do you want to be handed another intro to film, or do you want to come up with something? So I had a few ideas that I pitched, One of the ones that went through was, let's actually do something with Henson. And the immediate question among some of the faculty was, all right, so what is this going to be? How is this not a fluff class? And fortunately, right around that time, other Brian's biography of Jim Henson had just come out. And I knew a lot of the history already, but reading through and getting into some of it, you have a guy. You know, I wanted it to be a serious media history, media economics class. Also some regulation stuff, basically political, what you call political economy of mass media, if you're from a communications background. We have a course that handles that up until like the 40s. We didn't have anything that covered afterwards. Especially because we're more concentrated in film, we don't do that much with TV. So, I start looking at Henson's life, and you have this guy who breaks into television when it's mostly live, mostly local, low barriers to entry, so you could break into it pretty easily, but low returns, so you weren't getting rich right off the bat. And Henson's breaking in as a high schooler, as a teen puppeteer for a kid show, when kid shows were still local. He goes from that to having a local twice a night, 5-minute puppet show that's more aimed towards adult, the whole family, but you know, some twisted humor and things like that, when you can still do that, when the local TV affiliates would do that. He starts making television commercials from that right when advertising on TV is starting to get big. When a lot of products that are made locally and need local advertising more than national, and he is still doing commercials when that boom hits, when they're advertising nationwide products. He's attached to Sesame Street at the beginning of PBS. So right when we start to get public television hit it big, and I get to explain to the class, why do we have mostly a commercial for-profit model of TV versus like in England, the BBC, in Italy, La Rai.
I was gonna ask you about this later.
But all right, so I'll do the preview, I'll do the spoilers a little bit more, but you know, so yeah, I get to explain why we have this model, other countries have something different. There's a whole bunch of complicated regulatory stuff with the Muppet Show that I'm not even going to get into. But you have him then doing the first Muppet movies, when movies had been in a slump and were just coming back due to the blockbuster model. So I get to talk about that and then segue into the big special effects boom in the 80s and all these other practical special effects films that we didn't know at the time were going to be replaced by CGI-based films a decade later, happening in the 80s. Fraggle Rock is the first HBO original program. It's the predecessor to The Sopranos, Westworld, Game of Thrones, all of that stuff. So I get to explain, all right, how did cable even come about? Explaining the technologies and how it came around and what it was like before that. And the course ends, first of all, the course ends conveniently right before the internet. And the internet being kind of the point where most of the students in the class have lived and know what's up. They kind of intuitively know how media works past that point. But also when Henson was trying to sell out to Disney,
don't say sell out.
Well, right, that's something we're talking about. And he was basically going to be running the company more or less. He's trying to merge with Disney, be acquired by Disney, whatever, but goes from this kid who's working in local TV when you can do that to having production elements of his company in London, in New York, in Los Angeles, working in TV, movies, tons of merchandising stuff around it and so on, and about to be part of what is now probably the biggest entertainment media empire. So, whole sweep of it right there.
I think that sums up why I needed you here, because so much of what you just said is what I wanted to certainly get on mic for people listening at home and also get to students here who may not have had the opportunity to take your class just yet. Also, for those of you listening to this, just so we're clear, I will be referring to Brian Real as Brian and Brian J. Jones as Brian, so you will never be confused. You guys will never be confused either. I think we're all on the same page. Speaking of the different Brians, hi there.
Hey there, Jaden.
Welcome back.
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you again. So this here is Brian J. Jones, the author of Jim Henson, the biography, and I have a blurb. It said short. This is half a page. You want me to do the whole thing?
No, not really the whole thing, no.
You don't want me?
No, you don't have to do that.
Would you like to talk about yourself?
Or sure. I can make it very quick.
Cool.
So if anyone ever asks you what you're going to do with an English degree, because that was my major and my degree is in English, you can tell them you can go research and awesome people like Jim Henson with it. So I was actually in politics for 25 years, 30 years almost before I started writing biography. But the Washington Post has described my particular niche as slightly off-center American geniuses, which is a description I love. I've written biographies of Washington Irving, Jim Henson, George Lucas, and I'm now writing a biography of Dr. Seuss. So I pretty much own your collective childhoods. And what I love about biography more than anything is, and Brian and I were talking just before we came in, is you get to bury yourself in archives, and you get to, you get to interview cool people, and you get to, I love sense of place and sense of object, and one of the neat things when I was researching the Jim Henson book, it was they permitted me free and open access to their archives, which was one of the things I really wanted for that book. When I was discussing with the family, writing this book, and Lisa Henson said, if we tell you no, are you going to do it anyway? And I said, well, you really can't do it the way I would like to do it unless you have access to that archives. And their archives are not at the University of Connecticut, they're not at the University of Maryland, they are privately held in the offices of the Jim Henson Company in Long Island City, New York. So you have to have their permission to be in there. And so archives to me are always key. because you have great things. Jim was a great, I don't say hoarder, but he was one of these people who kept everything, and every once in a while he would just kind of empty junk from his pockets out into these boxes and just keep them. And it was Karen's job much later to go through and organize these things. But Jim would, I mean, he would keep everything. And so one of the great parts and the great fun of biography is going through these archives, and you'll pull out, you know, when Jim was doing The Muppet Show, he had a leather-bound folder that had his name on it and The Muppet Show logo, and the script for that week would go inside there. And he would hold it for the week and then replace it. I mean, so, you know, you get to hold that actual document, that actual object. One of the things I loved in the archives, and so much that I made a color photocopy of it, was Jim's passport. Because it's a normal passport, but when Jim was going between New York and London doing The Muppet Show, he was going back and forth almost weekly sometimes. So you will open up this passport, and almost an accordion falls out. They had to just keep adding pages to it as Jim went back and forth and back and forth. So there's just these long pages fall out of this thing, and they're stapled inside of it. And I actually photocopied just a picture of his main page with his photo, which even Jim Henson's photo or passport photo was terrible. And the other thing that I love about that is, you know, Jim, on in both his driver's license and his passport, self-reports his height as 6'2". I would ask every Muppet performer, everybody who knew Jim, tell me how tall Jim was. And they'd say, oh, well, I'm 6'4". He had to be 6'4", maybe 6'6". They'd say he's 6'2". He can't be 6'2". I'm 6'2". Frank Oz, I'm 6'2". Jim was taller than me. Nope, just goes to show you the way Jim was regarded by people. He was 6'2", and everyone to a person swore he was much taller than that.
Wow. And now I have to try to find a segue from that to my slideshow. And so, speaking of that, I'm going to talk about something completely different.
Okay. Nice segue.
I know, right? I'm so smooth. You can tell I've done these events so many times. So what you're looking at right here, this. Is the cast of Sam and Friends. You'll recognize Kermit the Frog. You probably will not recognize anyone else. This was the show that Jim Henson was working on right here when he was living in Hyattsville, just down the road. And I think it's worth, since we're talking about changes in the industry and the relationship between that and Henson's career, I think we should first clarify what it is that made the creation of the Muppets, even just this very primitive form of them, so different. What makes these puppets, Brian, different from the way that puppetry had been done before?
Let me tell you. So one of the big things about the Muppets, and the Muppets especially in the early days on TV, is because we were all raised, even I'm not old enough to have been raised in this. I was generation 1.0 for Sesame Street. But so we all grew up in an era when we know what puppets look like in TVs. They have functioning mouths, you know, they have, so, and they use the entire space on the TV screen. Mm-hmm. Before Jim came along, a puppet show, puppets on television, was essentially somebody would set up a puppet theater, they would hang a curtain on it, the puppeteer would stand behind it and poke the puppets out from behind it. Puppets like Kukofran and Ollie, the main character had a painted face, little hands that you'd move with your fingers like this, the mouth didn't move, it was painted. Jim realized when he gets into puppets on TV, you gotta get rid of that, because you're on TV, that camera is in there close. This is not a puppet show. So you make a puppet there, the mouth opens. So that's actually already a big innovation with puppets on TV, is all of Jim's puppets have mouths that operate. Jim's actually figured out how to create the eyes. If you slightly cross them, they actually all of a sudden focus. So they actually appear that they're paying attention to the camera. So Muppets are built for TV in those two ways automatically. First of all, the mouths work and the eyes are focused. But the other thing Jim figures out, which you can't just tell from this, but is if you're on TV, you don't need that puppet theater. Jim knows intuitively that the puppet theater is the four sides of the TV screen. Throw out the puppet theater and use the entire space. And maybe JD will show you some of these, but if you watch Muppet routines on 60s, Jim's got him coming in from the bottom. You watch Phenomena, he comes in from the side, he comes in from the top, he raises up from the bottom. Jim throws out that puppet theater. That's so, this didn't look like anything else you would have seen on TV at the time, because until then, it was a little filmed puppet show like you would see at a birthday party.
And he could work with a monitor.
Right, that's a huge innovation.
The fact that he could look over and see what the viewers would see, there was always a monitor working as part of this to do it. And it's worth keeping in mind that we always think of movies and TV as connected, that TV evolved out of movies, which isn't really that much the case, as much as you would think. TV replaced people's radios more so. That most of radio, it wasn't just playing, you know, whatever pop albums or whatever, and some talk stuff. It was live drama, things like that. And a big sell of radio was that it was direct, it was live, and so forth. Television, for its early years, was doing a lot of live plays, a lot of we're broadcasting from wherever. Since that was still expensive to do, you would get, that's why you had so much local programming, because there was still that attraction to it being live and having that in it. But they also weren't necessarily looking at quite the same innovations as that movies had had for the, at least the first few years.
So I think because you were talking about the nature of television at the time, we should talk about Jim's commercials. Because here's just one little frame I found. I'm not going to be showing videos tonight, partly for legal reasons. I don't know that I'd be allowed to show videos, especially if this is going out online. But also, I would like to make sure that you all go see a lot of this video footage at the event that's going to happen next week. Next week, again, you'll get to see these in far better quality than I could present them if I wanted to. But what you're seeing right here is a gun pointed at a cute, adorable little puppet who will not buy Wilkins coffee. And that's almost the setup for most of these commercials. You have Wilkins over there, who's on your right, who wants you to buy Wilkins coffee. Then there's Wonkins, and he won't have Wilkins coffee. He doesn't want to drink any. And so you get commercial after commercial, where it's some setup that ends up with Wonkins getting hurt. And it can be pretty violent. Sometimes it's a cannon pointed at him that gets then turned at the audience. So what do you think of Wilkins? There's one in which he gets sent to the electric chair. Am I missing any good ones?
One, the Washington Monument falls on him. Mm-hmm. Another time, Mr. Wilkins himself crushes Wilkins. Yeah. Another time, he blows up the TV. Yeah, there's all sorts of terrible ways of dispensing with Wilkins.
And it's shocking to us because it seems so, once he gets stabbed with a knife, I love
that's
that
true.
One.
Another time, he gets cut by a buzzsaw.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
itchy and scratchy,
essentially. So, this strikes us as interesting because we wouldn't expect that kind of violence from television. But I think because it was basically cartoon violence, this probably would have been seen as still interesting, but that was probably what made it okay. The reason why I brought this up is because these were commercials that weren't doing the hard sell, they were funny. And that strikes me as unusual for the time, would you say?
Somewhat. It was, and commercials were a lot shorter too. They were just a few seconds rather than, about 10 seconds maybe, instead of the usual 30 seconds, they would just be more of a, they were closer to magazine advertising even. They figured out that it was a visual form. They didn't really have the long form narrative figured out. So Henson's kind of working when that develops, and by the time he's out of the commercial game, you have DDB. Look it up, I can't remember what DB, but the huge advertising company, and basically the Mad Men era. And he could have actually kept that going. He could have made an entire career out of that, except he had other TV projects, Sesame Street and so on, launching, and he decided to do, the less selling out thing.
If you watch Mad Men, you'll actually hear a throwaway line in one episode where they're working on something and they say they've actually used puppets to sell coffee, they're trying to figure out their coffee campaign, and they actually they don't mention the Muppets, they talk about using puppets to sell coffee.
But what's fascinating about these two, so Wilkins Coffee was a local area DC brand, but I'm trying to think of some of the other brands.
Crammel Milk. There was, I can't remember the one down in Boston.
But just coffee.
One in New Orleans. So.
A community coffee, which I went to a community coffee shop while in New Orleans. And there's all these other coffee brands where there's ads that are the same puppets. They don't use the same names. I don't think that they use names in the other ones.
No, they did. And what's interesting is Jim could have probably taken his old commercials and just redubbed them with them saying the names of the other commercial, but he wouldn't do that because the mouth wouldn't have looked right. So Jim would actually refilm. Because what happens is people would see these commercials and say, we want that for our coffee we're selling in Boston. And rather than just say, fine, you can pay me and here's the commercial, we'll just redub it, Jim would actually reshoot the commercial with their logo hanging in the background.
How much filming did he do?
Tons.
Lots of it. He actually did it, it was in right across the river in Washington, D.C., right over where the subway is over there.
Yeah, but all these different coffee brands, it's this bizarre thing where 5 years later, he wouldn't have been able to get away with that. Right. What it was at the time is that you have this period of innovation where televisions coming into people's homes around the same time that we're building the national highway system. And they're doing some expansions on rail freight at the time, plus refrigerated cars, things like that, that all came together to make national brands. Before that, each region would have a coffee company. So he could self-plagiarize and sell to another market, and Old Man Wilkins didn't care. It's a completely different market for that. He cares about selling his own coffee in DC, part of Maryland, part of Virginia. That's it.
And this is right after you've had the comic book problem, the Seduction of the Innocent, issues with violence in comics. Mm-hmm. Everyone's turning to go, you know, put their focus on comic books, and Jim's doing this in plain sight on TV across the country, finally, at one point. And what's interesting is you have people who were just, you know, some people are beside themselves about violence on TV and violence in comics, and there's actually, I think, a bit of the letters in the book. There's a U.S. congressman who, somebody asked him about it, and he says, I think they're charming. So there was something about the way Jim did this that people just, somebody actually wrote a note and said, well, everybody wants to kill their spouse in the morning anyway. So I think Jim just got away with it because look at these guys. They're not going to hurt anybody. He really gets away with it. And again, this is Jim's design sense, also you're seeing up here. This is Ernie and Bert. This is short and fat and tall and skinny. Mm-hmm. It's Beaker and Bunsen. So you're already seeing Jim's design sense show up in these commercials. It's very easy to understand right away. You know who's going to get it just looking at the way these characters are.
It's probably a subliminal classic form as well, because it's also Laurel and Hardy and 50
Adam
other.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That he would have seen how many times over.
Now, it's interesting because in a way, Jim's commercial work led right into Sesame Street, or that was what got him, that's what got the folks at Sesame interested in Henson's work. And yet, he takes a detour before Sesame, or sort of as he's doing commercials. He moves into experimental filmmaking with stuff like The Cube and Timepiece and Youth 68, these films that are, in some cases, almost like avant-garde films. Certainly in the case of Timepiece, that is just quick-cut montage, very, very strange. You cut from Jim running while wearing a suit to painting an elephant pink to a gorilla on a pogo stick, just seemingly random cuts all around. And my first question is, what would explain this surprising detour in Henson's career, or is it even a detour? Is it something that Henson wanted to do all along?
Let me start, and I'll go to you, because you'll be able to answer it in the larger context. Let me answer it in the context of Jim. So I think the 60s is probably the most fascinating period in Jim's life, because Jim's born in 36, so when the 60s come along, he's not quite really a hippie. He's already married with a family when, you know, his first child's born in 1960. But Jim, you know, he looks like a hippie, but Jim's really trying to figure out what he wants to do still. He doesn't really know if this, you know, he loves the Muppets. He considers himself kind of a filmmaker. So in the 60s, what I love about Jim's work in the 60s is it's him trying a little bit of everything to see what he wants to do. And what's really fascinating to me, if you pull the newspaper ads he puts in the papers in New York City at that time, promoting his company's Muppets Incorporated. So he's got these ads talking about the Muppets, and he says, we do short films like Timepiece. We do little documentaries like Youth 68. We do The Cube, these experimental pieces like this. And we also do puppets. It's the very last thing he puts on the list. I mean, Jim almost considers, I don't think he considers the Muppets kid stuff. He doesn't consider it slumming, but it's just one of the many things he does. So the 60s is an era I love because it's Jim as an artist. It's Jim trying to decide as an artist, what's he gonna do? And he does have the luxury, and this is what I'll turn over to Brian, he has the luxury of time and money to do that at this point in his career, because he is making a lot of money from his commercial work. And you remember a couple of years ago during the Super Bowl when the Muppets were doing commercials for Toyota or something, and people were wringing their hands on the internet and on Twitter. Jim would be rolling over in his grave. The Muppets are selling cars. So we just saw the Muppets have been selling stuff since 1958. So that actually gave Jim his artistic and creative freedom. He needed to do all sorts of things while he figures out what he's going to do.
Yeah, and he liked toys. Anytime he could get his hands on some sort of new technology to experiment with, you can think of the Muppets as sort of a technology. You can think of TV, you can definitely think of TV as a technology. What we were saying earlier about the television itself being the puppet theater, the stage and things like that, and him figuring out problems, I think that's just how he thought. He was like, what can I do with this? And you see it later in his career too. If he had not passed away so early, he would have gone full forward into some of the CGI, into some of the computer stuff and so on. And when you see some of his experiments, he's doing certain quick cuts, certain edits that he would have seen among, you know, D.A. Pennybaker and other independent avant-garde filmmakers that were part of the New York scene especially. He would have had access to this. He would have been able to see screenings in the community and so on, and wanted to be part of that. It was the cool kids making cool stuff. But unlike a lot of them, he did have that luxury. He could go and buy another 8mm, 16mm camera. He could go get film stock. He did some of the work for NBC, where he was able to walk in and actually get a contract and then get access to video cameras when they were new.
And chroma key technology, something as mundane as that nowadays. Jim loved chroma key technology, wanted to play with it so badly. I think that's one of the reasons he made the Youth 68 documentary, just so he could put in the chroma key moments in there.
Yeah, with chroma key being green screen or blue screen.
Yeah.
It's, you know, what the weatherman is standing in front of, and that was their practical use, but they figured it out on television and with video. And of course, I would have gone with the Cloverland Cow example, but you know,
right.
Which is one of my favorite commercials of him that doesn't really fit in with the rest. But yeah, he wanted to try new stuff and like new toys.
I think it was also a different time period in that people were actually going to a space where they were showing art films.
Right.
I don't know where you would even do that now, but it
you
seems
do.
Like it was a part of it. Yeah, pretty much. And so I think that does reflect something about the way that people were watching media at the time, much like the way that they were watching public television, watching private television instead of public television. I almost made a successful segue for once to where we're heading now, which is to Sesame Street. And what we have with Sesame Street is a show that I think is interesting because it's very, very difficult to point to any earlier educational television in America, or at least anything that we would normally recognize as educational television. I can't think of much.
Mr. Rogers.
Rogers shows up 1 year before in Canada.
Yeah, and there was a predecessor to PBS, which was National Education Television, but it wasn't the same.
Yeah.
It had very few national programs, and Sesame Street is coming on the air only a couple years after television is starting to be more firmly a national thing. That, you know, I should look up when the tipping point hit where more than half a program would have been national, you know, either from the national networks or the local, or from syndicated shows made by one affiliate. But yeah, it's getting to the point where that's happening. And NET just never really took off though. It got some grant funding, but once they got federal funding behind PBS and they started to deliberately plan and so forth, and then they have Mr. Rogers was a hit, Sesame Street was a bigger hit.
And before Sesame Street comes along, you do have attempts at educational television, like Brian was saying. A lot of times it was an educator sitting at a table staring at the camera, reading their notes, or standing in front of a black, it was almost like a filmed high school or college lecture. On the flip side of that, you would have Romper Room, which was essentially a kindergarten class with a teacher trying to get control of this class by reading them stories. Some of them, you know, you probably did learn some things from watching the teacher in front of you. But if you're trying to get six-year-olds to actually learn how to read and learn their numbers and learn their letters, you can't just have somebody lecturing to them, and you can't just make it about kindergarten class. So that was one of the things. What's the quote about TV being the vast wasteland? That had just been said right around the time Sesame Street
was
coming out.
Like that.
And so I think one of the things that they were doing with Sesame Street is they were saying, look, we're going to take the pedagogy of the people standing and lecturing, but we wanted to have some of the fun of Romper Room. So they're trying to sort of walk a fine line and do something that hadn't really ever been done before with Sesame Street.
And you're also at a time period where, you know, as I point out in the course, we did not have to do the commercial model of television. We could have done a BBC model or La Rai or whatever, but it basically built off of radio, which had gone that direction and gone that way more haphazard because it's very easy to build a radio tower and start transmitting.
I just want to clarify, in the UK,
yep.
In radio and in television, it starts off being very, very government controlled, it's not privatized, mm-hmm. and then they move to the commercial stuff. In the US, we immediately were like, no, private ownership.
But their public stuff is still much stronger than what we have. But there was still regulation over it, and there was always this back and forth. We're probably at our loosest regulatory point right now. But before that, there was a lot of question of what is this doing to people, and if we're going to grant broadcast licenses and things like that, if these three companies are going to have an effective monopoly over the three major channels at the time, when you have monopolies or oligopolies, the government starts regulating basically with the argument that you should have some form of public obligation. So, and this still exists to a certain degree, but it used to be that the networks had to give up a certain number of hours for things that were in the public interest, for public affairs programs and so forth. So they would have to have certain shows that would present politics, that would present political debate, that would be outright educational. And they, as much as they would try to relegate that to being off hours as much as possible, you still see networks filling some obligations at like 7 a.m. on Sunday, for example. They were getting a lot more of a push to do like Sunday prime time was one of the points, where you have to give up some prime time hour and so on. So for the different commercial networks, they were not against public television. They didn't think of it as competition, I think, until Sesame Street came on the air.
Right.
Public
television was no fun until Sesame Street.
Right. They were like, you want to do this on a national scale and so forth. If you're a network executive, you're thinking to yourself, all right, well, next time the government regulators are coming around or somebody's trying to pass a bill to make me give up more time where I can actually sell stuff and get eyes on the TV, I'm going to say, well, don't you already have this whole national public television program? Why are we paying taxes into that? So the networks were behind it. The networks actually helped build the show a lot, and they weren't ready for it to
be on the cover of Time magazine within 2 months.
And to be more popular than their non-education fairyland shows that they were doing in the morning.
And Jim's involvement in Sesame Street was, Jim comes into the Sesame Street process, the development, a little bit late. Sesame Street, Jim would have called them eggheads. Is actually developed by educators and intellectuals putting together a meaningful pedagogy behind this. But they also knew early on that if you're going to hold kids' attention, you need puppets. And people who were familiar with Jim's work from variety shows and from the Wilkins commercials, Joan Ganz Cooney, who actually is considered the mother of Sesame Street, her first knowledge of Jim was watching Wilkins and Wilkins do terrible things to each other. She was the one who said, you know, we've got to bring this guy in. And Jim was so important to Sesame Street that John Stone, who's or the father of Sesame Street, said, if you can't get Jim to do puppets, you can't have puppets on Sesame Street. But what initially happened was they kept the Muppets in their own separate segments.
Mm-hmm.
Because the educators were saying, you can't put the puppets on the street, children won't understand this is not reality, and the Muppets have to be by themselves, the grown-ups have to be by themselves, never the twain shall meet. And what they found when they did their first test shows is that the kids were watching and paying attention and engaged when the Muppets were there. And as soon as we went back to poor Gordon and Bob and Mr. Hooper, they all tuned out. So they knew they had to get puppets onto the street. So Jim's, one of his big contributions, apart from just the Muppet segments, is Jim's the one who said, get Big Bird out there. He is the child's point of view. Get Big Bird out there, and weirdly enough, get Oscar out there. So the reason Big Bird and Oscar reside on Sesame Street was to get them onto the street where the real people were living, because the kids were not watching until that happened.
You mentioned the way that television was regulated to try to separate programming from time to time, and I think that probably relates to the issue of syndication, which is something we kind of take for granted now. We take it for granted that some amount of television is going to be syndicated. And could you explain a little bit about, first of all, just what syndication is, and then how it came about?
Then we're going into Sesame Street, right?
I was going
to... Or not Sesame Street, to Muppet
Show. I'm moving towards the Muppet Show. You caught my segue.
Yep.
Good job.
All right. Get ready, because this is going to be a boring ride.
I learned way more about syndication writing this chapter than I ever thought I would.
So, take it away. Basically, Sesame Street's a hit. The commercials have been around. Something that we kind of skipped over is Henson had been a fixture on The Tonight Show, on The Jimmy Dean Show. The guy who now sells sausages used to be a cowboy. Cowboy singer, and Rolf was one of his regular guest stars. That's where Rolf got his... Rolf was a national star before Kermit. So Henson's known. Henson is a known hot property, and he wants to do a Muppet Show. People are questioning it, but it looks like it's going to be able to happen. And he finally starts to get to a point where he's worked out a deal with CBS, that they're interested in moving forward. A few of the networks were starting to move that way. And then the financial interest and syndication rules, or FinCEN, were passed, which is basically a packet of regulations that said, and there was another rule that went along with it that is falling out of my head, that are... Usually people say FinCEN, but there's a whole other packet of legislation that said a certain number of hours have to be independent producers, so the networks can't produce their own stuff. And the idea was, it makes more variety for TV. That if the networks are just producing their own show, they're going to go for the lowest common denominator, while if they have to buy a certain amount of outside stuff, there's going to be competition for good product. And there's going to be different ideas, different shows.
An example of something that we see syndicated now would be something like Jeopardy, right? Because that's not on a specific network. If you live here, it'll be on with one network. So, if you live somewhere else in the country, it could be on a different network.
Exactly. Backing up, so syndication is another idea where something that's not the network produces a show, and networks across the country can buy it and air it when they want. And now Jeopardy, though, does have a deal with, or do they on here, ABC for the most, ABC or CBS?
I can't remember.
But, you know, Oprah used to have a deal with ABC where she could be on other networks in certain markets if other networks were going to pay more, but for the most part, you get the idea. And a lot of the times it would come out of one network's doing a local show, the whole country picks it up and sells it across the country. So that's what syndication is, and it's still around now. But not as much, because a lot of stuff goes straight to cable and so on. And it's just on this one cable channel instead of... And then there's second-run syndication. After a show's been on for a while, it's while you'll see The Simpsons or whatever sitcom that's been on a few years in the afternoon on a certain show. But going back to FinCEN, a bunch of regulations said to the TV networks, you can only show so much stuff that you made, and you have to buy from outside producers. So these networks that they're going through their renewals and cancellations, suddenly they're basically saying, you're losing what averages out to a little bit more than an hour per night of your time slots where you can have shows that you actually produce. So when the networks have been increasing the number of shows they produce and they're suddenly cut back that much, there's suddenly no space. However, CBS is, you know, good with Henson right now, so The deal was more or less, if you go and find a way to produce this show, we'll show it on some of your networks. Other regulations made it so that each network, CBS, NBC, ABC, could own and operate a certain number of stations. And because they're limited by number, not as much by market, they're going to pick some of the big major city markets, and then the other affiliates are owned by private companies, but make agreements to show what the national network is showing in prime time. So CBS is like, you make the show, we'll show it at the same time on all of our owned and operated stations. Most of the others will follow. So, bizarrely, that's how The Muppet Show ends up over in England. I think you can probably talk about that better than me.
Yeah, yes. The way it ends up in England is Jim starts working with CBS early with trying to fund a pilot through CBS that he thinks will sell. Does a 30-minute pitch reel, which you should Google it or look it up on YouTube. It's hilarious. Mm-hmm. And CBS passes on actually owning the show. But they do say, look, if you can make this, we'll be happy to show it. And Jim really can't find anybody who will help him make it. He's actually had three strikes already. He's made three different pilots with ABC, mm-hmm. None of which land. Muppet Show is a real study in perseverance because Jim's tried three times for this. He knows the Muppets will work. He's been pitching. If you go, and maybe Karen will talk about this later. Next week, there's proposals for a half-hour Muppet Show TV show in his archives as early as like 1965. Like, Jim knows this is going to work, but can't stick the landing. He can't find anybody that's going to produce it. Finally, he ends up talking with Lord Lou Grade at ATV in England, it's really one of those where it's a good fit, because Lou Grade is a guy who did Space 1999 and so on. But Lou Grade comes out of the English version of vaudeville. He's a showman. He's sort of an old school showman. Really sort of gets Jim, understands what Jim wants to do. And Jim had a real knack for sitting down in business meetings and pulling on puppets and just killing in the room. And Lord Grade really responded to that and, basically tells Jim, without even really having to see much of anything but just knowing Jim, I'll give you $125,000 per episode for 26 episodes, which at that time was a phenomenal amount of money for a half-hour comedy series in syndication.
Yeah, 1970s money.
1975 is when this starts. So I haven't ever done the actual math on this, but I believe it was the most expensive half-hour comedy, over a network at the time. Because that's the kind of money Lord Grade was going to put into this. Knew Jim was the right guy, but the condition was, I have a studio sitting empty over here in L Street in London. You come and use my studio. So there was a little bit of self-interest in Lord Grade at that point, too. He wanted that space used. This is a space where they'd been making James Bond movies and things like that, just sitting empty. I think when they moved in, I think Murder on the Orient Express was the last movie that had ever been made in there. So Jim comes in and essentially just takes over L Street TV studios. Across the street from him, actually in 1976, George Lucas is making Star Wars in the movie studios across the street from L Street's TV studios. So that's when those two sort of size each other at one point. But anyway, the real reason he ends up in London is because Lord Grade has these studios laying fallow over there. So Jim, without even really telling his wife or anybody else, signs the papers and is like, we are going to London, and is in London for the next 5 years.
So once they're over there in London, right across from the folks making Star Wars, did that segue, ultimately lead to
Brian's next one?
I knew you were going to do that. Somewhat, yes. And Lucas had a lot of respect for Jim, and Jim had a lot of respect for George Lucas, partly because, again, sort of like Jim with Lord Grade, they were cut out of the same cloth. They were both these fiercely independent people, owned their own companies. Lucas, people forget, Star Wars was essentially an independent film. Mm-hmm. Lucas financed this thing himself, was pissed at 20th Century Fox the entire time, only grudgingly let them distribute it, and really saw a kindred spirit in Jim. But what's really going on with Yoda is this is sort of technology transfer between the Henson Company and Lucasfilm. Because Lucas knows he wants Yoda to work. Lucas had a number of things he wanted to do. First, to put a monkey in a costume. He decided that wasn't going to work. Are you going to make a midget for it? I don't think that's going to work. So they decided that it was going to be a puppet. That's the only way to pull this thing off. And if you want a puppet, you'd better bring in the best puppeteer. So they approach Jim to do Yoda, and Jim actually says, you want Frank Oz to perform, and he's a better performer than I am. But Jim wants to make the Dark Crystal at this time as well, too. He wants the technology you're going to need to make the Dark Crystal. And who does special effects at this point better than anybody? Lucasfilm. So it's sort of these two corporations collaborating, trying to get something out of it. You know, Lucas wants Jim's expertise in performance and puppet building, and Jim wants Lucas's expertise in building these special effects. Yoda is essentially a special effect. Frank Oz, there's a great quote in the book where Frank Oz talks about Yoda being really effing heavy. Because, as Frank Oz puts it, they still built a special effect. He's not really an entirely functional puppet. He said the weight, it's built out of rubber that's not entirely pliable. It rests on this part of your hand instead of up here, so he said it was painful to operate for a long time. But they were learning. They were getting the ears that would wiggle with the remote control thing. So Jim's getting the technology he needs to then move forward with Dark Crystal.
Well, so this gets us to Dark Crystal. And I'm interested in this because it seems like through that interaction, whether they knew it or not, they sort of ended up, it seems to me, almost defining a decade of what the special effects of the 80s were going to be. Can you talk at all about any of the other stylistic elements or the special effects elements that factored into a lot of what we know or think we know about 80s special effects cinema?
Yeah, where does this one sit, you think, in 80s fantasy cinema? You know, I mean, it wasn't necessarily the thing that spawned, you know, Legend or anything like that. I think that came more out of Star Wars, but where does this one sit?
And it's kind of running parallel to everything. Yeah. It's hard to get its placement, especially because it was a flop.
Right.
And...
yeah, Jim was right about this one, but at the wrong time.
Yeah, and, you know, he tried to fix a lot of that with Labyrinth, which...
flopped.
But... Labyrinth had a pretty quick turnaround to come back to, you know, jumping a little forward before going backwards. Labyrinth flopped right when everybody was starting to have VCRs in their house,
right?
Or at least knew somebody who did. So suddenly there's this whole aftermarket for it. Dark Crystal was right before that. It flopped and flopped.
Right.
But in general, though, there is a special effect craze that is coming off of Star Wars still. And if you look at some of the reviews for Dark Crystal, you can see it is called a Star Wars knockoff, which seems utterly ridiculous.
Right.
It's, you would think of it now, especially when we see how many genuine Star Wars knockoff, how many you know, other space-themed films and so on. This is entirely on another planet. It's a different culture. It's not technology-driven.
There are no humans here in this film.
No, but it's just
puppets.
How much genre, what we now call genre film, wasn't really a thing yet. But it was piling up just because the cost of the special effects were coming down and the technologies were coming into place.
Yeah, now, when you watch Dark Crystal, the really wonderful thing about it, and I think Dark Crystal has its problems, is everything you see up here is real. I mean, everything exists.
Mm-hmm.
There are actually no visual effects in Dark Crystal except for, I think, a sky at one point as a special effect. Everything else you see is built, and what people told me is not only was it built, they said you could walk around behind the set and it was still finished in the back. You know, in Pixar they call it painting the drawers, like you know, the bottom of the drawer is finished. Everything in Dark Crystal is built. Dark Crystal is really important in Jim's development as an artist because Dark Crystal looks exactly the way Jim wants it to look. It's the first time he's been able to put something up on screen that really expresses his own artistic view. This movie baffled people. And I told Lisa Henson that I was part of their problem. I was 12 when Dark Crystal came out, and I saw this in the theater, and I walked out of there going, what in the hell was that? Jim really struggled with it as well. And when he's doing his media tour on this, he's trying his best to promote Dark Crystal and these brand new ideas and these creatures that don't look like anything else. And the first question he gets from everybody is, where are the Muppets? Nobody understood this. Jim was trying to grow up, and nobody was letting him do it. Now you have to understand, Jim never thought puppets were for kids. But what had happened to him with Sesame Street was Sesame Street almost boxed him in. Because you saw someone who was talking about what was going on in the 60s, where Jim's got all these other projects he's juggling, and he's really considering himself an avant-garde filmmaker and making commercials. And then he lands Sesame Street, which becomes hugely successful. And Jim doesn't become just defined as a puppeteer at that point. He becomes defined as a children's puppeteer, which he never considered himself to be. So this is Jim trying to break that mold and sort of a very aggressively do it. And it really doesn't land. And again, partly it's because Dark Crystal has its problems. I find it to be a terribly slow story. Mm-hmm. But again, I think people weren't ready for it. I mean, people weren't ready. This is Jim Henson Productions. I went to the studio, to the theater at age 12 and walked out there going, I don't know what that was.
Where are the jokes?
Yeah, and that was, I think that was a big part of his problem, was expectations were so different for it as well.
So as you know, Brian, but I'm not sure you know Brian, I've been working on this paper that's actually about Labyrinth and the Dark Crystal, mostly Labyrinth. Yeah. I've been doing this for an independent study course I'm doing here, I've been trying to contextualize these films within the other fantasy films of the 80s. Because in the 80s, there are just a lot of fantasy films. You don't see many before that, you don't see many after that. You've got your Legend, Willow, Lady Hawk, Neverending Story.
And then you get to the end of it where it turns into self-parody with Gremlins and things like that. And then parody of parody with Gremlins 2 and Ryder crossing into the 90s, but yeah.
So it's a genre that seems to be all over the place. Some of it's for kids, like Return to Oz. Some of it is definitely not for kids, like a lot of the sword and sorcery films they were doing based on old Pulp Fiction novels. And so I've had to ask, why the 80s?
It's just because the technology is there. And it's also, you see, it's the most logical statement make, but the best point, the highest artistic point of a use of technology is going to be right before it becomes irrelevant. And we were reaching a point where certain practical effects had been developing since the dawn of film, had been developing since Méliès, and we're now with some of the drive, with some of the puppetry, and because it was never just the puppetry, Henson was more focused on that, but it was other elements being brought into some of the visual tricks that they figured out they could do. The reach and the money, especially once home video hit, and there was a stronger secondary market, and with cable too. That there was this aftermarket with cable that didn't exist. You could put more money behind films and actually get it back. So having that driving into it, you see the biggest advancement in this, and then CGI comes along, Jurassic Park comes along, and it's like...
Yeah. As I was reading a bit about the history of fantasy films, David Butler, who has a great book, a nice academic text on fantasy cinema, he talks about how there were a lot of fantasy movies that were actually just waiting in the wings in Hollywood to be made during the 70s.
Yeah.
And everyone was just afraid to do it. No one was willing to make a fantasy film in the 70s because it just wasn't a genre at the time.
Right.
It just wasn't there. And then Star Wars comes along, and suddenly there's this boost in confidence. Like, hey, wait a second. Yeah, maybe something kind of fantastic could work. And so then you get this, what Butler calls an 80s a fantasy boom in the 80s. And what's interesting is you get different kinds of films during this time that are looking at fantasy literature, fairy tales, legend, mythology, all that stuff, in different contexts. They're approaching it in different ways, and that's part of what interests me about this. So if you don't mind, I'm going to go a little bit into what I've been doing for my directed study, a little bit of film analysis, if you will, very briefly, to talk about The Dark Crystal and Labyrinth. So with The Dark Crystal, you have basically a fairy tale. It's supposed to be a straight-up fairy tale, a pretty standard myth in most respects, these timeless ideas of good versus evil. And what comes with adapting a fairy tale straight is you actually end up with some of the ideology of the classic fairy tale and the classic myth. And that ideology has typically focused, for various historical reasons, on basically obeying and conforming and doing what you're told, and being the person your culture, your society wants you to be. And I think with The Dark Crystal, you see a bit of this. I've got this quote here, "I will go where you send me, though I barely understand." And it's a whole story about obedience. You have him conforming to this narrative. You see there's a prophecy. I don't know if you can see the picture well, but there's a prophecy about the Dark Crystal and how the last remaining Gelfling is supposed to heal the crystal. So he has a job according to a narrative of what he's supposed to be, and the graven image of what he's supposed to do. And then you get Labyrinth, which is very different, because here you have to be a skeptic. You can't trust the usual rules of fairy tales. The fairies will bite you. It's not about being obedient. Jareth the Goblin King, played by David Bowie, tells Jennifer Connelly, "Do not defy me." And the whole movie is going to be her defying him. And then there's the conformity to the image of the princess. She has this music box of the princess in the ballroom, and she eventually becomes that through some of Jareth's magic, and then she has to break that when she smashes a mirror, which is in a way smashing this image of herself as the fairy tale figure. So it seems to me like there is almost a complete ideological turnaround between the two films, and I've struggled to figure out why, because according to this one article from the New York Times that was promoting The Dark Crystal, the genesis of Labyrinth was Mr. Henson's desire to correct what he sees as the one failure of his 1983 movie, The Dark Crystal. There were no human beings in it. And it's weird to say that's the only thing Henson saw wrong with The Dark Crystal, because he changed so much between The Dark Crystal and Labyrinth. Mm-hmm. And so I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what some of those changes were and why you think he might have made some.
Well, I do love that, you know, he was actually, that's a story he told where he was sitting in a car with Brian Froud, who was the artist behind the development of Dark Crystal and the look that it had. And they were leaving a showing of it, and the audience had not been terribly enthusiastic. And Jim starts breaking down in laughter about it and saying, well, the next one will be better. The problem is we didn't have any people in it, which just baffles me that he thought that was the problem on it. You know, he ran into a similar problem with Labyrinth, though, because what Jim loved to do, and I think the reason that both Dark Crystal and Labyrinth look exactly the way Jim wanted them to look, is Jim was really more concerned with sort of what Brian was saying. Jim loved the technology, and he was getting a lot of technology to play with in both movies. But Jim loved world building. Jim loved world building almost to the cost of plot and story. And so what happens in Labyrinth is Jim, in his notebooks, he's got very rough notes on Labyrinth, what's he gonna call it. He's got sort of notes on vignettes, but he doesn't really have a plot for Labyrinth. And so he starts bringing in one writer after another to start working on Labyrinth. And it really becomes sort of the too many cooks syndrome after a while. And he's got great people writing. He's got Elaine May comes in at one point. He's got Terry Jones from Monty Python, who actually I think still has the story credit on it, but it's not really his original script isn't really there. There's pieces of it. I can't even come up with him right. He brings in one person after another to write the script. Mm-hmm. There's an awful lot of hands on the script for Labyrinth, which is where I think you've got some problems with it. It doesn't have a consistent voice. It doesn't really always have a consistent feel. It doesn't always know what it wants to be. But damn it, if it doesn't look fantastic. And that's, again, because, you know, Jim's worrying about the world building side of it. Jim knows how he wants this thing to look. He loves this dance scene. He loves the Escher room. You know, he told somebody at one point, if you take the Escher room out of my movie, you clearly don't understand my movie. So Jim's really, really stuck on the look of this movie, and he's leaving the writing of it kind of to others at his peril, in a way. Because again, I do think that's the biggest problem with Labyrinth. There were an awful lot of hands on the script, but it looks fantastic.
Well, if Karen Falk were here, who's the archivist for the Jim Henson Company, I think that she would add, you know, in terms of the world building or what it was that drove him in certain directions. I point to the technology because that's where I come out of. But it's also, Karen would say, he was a designer.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
He did, he used to do a screen printing business here on campus where he would design posters for different plays, different student groups, and so forth. You look through his notebooks, he has doodles and sketches. We actually had an exhibit here on campus. Jim Henson, Doodles and Designs, I believe. Designs and Doodles.
Jim was actually trying to launch a clothing line based on both Dark Crystal and Labyrinth. So.
Which you could do now.
Right.
Yeah.
I think they have done it now.
Well,
they tried to.
You often see on like T-Fury and Teespring and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Some of the band designs for Labyrinth and Dark Crystal on that.
Yeah, he was very into costume balls every year.
I think he wanted you to be able to dress like Jared.
Exactly.
Though, is.
Well, that's the cosplayers I see at various conventions.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, if you launched it now, it would work. But he was a graphic artist in many ways, and that you can see, especially in these two films. You can see a line with these films, and then going back to some of his independent and avant-garde work of that aesthetic and that part of him, and he since he was a multimedia artist as well, he would draw, he would paint, etc. Just being able to grab a new camera, have an animation stand that he had at one point so he could actually make cartoons, other things like that, is just an extension of him doing stuff like that. And he could have had an entire career as, you know, basically a 2D visual artist doing posters, could have been the next Sal Bass. But just a quick plug too, so Karen from the Henson Company has a background in design and did a book on a lot of Henson's work, materials from the archives. So if you want to see an amazing book of a somebody with a design aesthetic doing a book about somebody with a design aesthetic,
yeah.
Imagination Illustrated, it's worth looking up.
And the other fun thing about Labyrinth, and this again gets back to Brian's point about Jim as the gadget guy who loved, so Jim actually has CGI in Labyrinth, but it's not any place you would expect it. Jim blows his load very early. He uses CGI for the opening credits. There's an owl that's flying over the opening credits. So it's actually the very first time we actually had a real non-fantasy animal animated by the computer. You had spaceships and, you know, some dragon things. It's the first actual real animal. It's a white owl flying over the opening credits, and which is, you know, water and a dropping in the water. And that's Jim's CGI. He was so excited about it, he uses it on the opening credits and gets it out of the way. And there's no more CGI in the movie.
He did that twice in his career.
He does it with the Jim Henson Hour.
The Jim Henson Hour, he blew how much of his season one budget on this.
And didn't care.
And it doesn't. The opening to Labyrinth still looks good. The opening to the Jim Henson Hour,
it looks like a local commercial.
Yeah, it does. It looks like when your local car dealership decides to have a CGI character.
Yeah.
So at this point, I mean, once he's moved from Labyrinth, The Dark Crystal has flopped, Labyrinth has flopped, and then the Jim Henson Hour comes along, and it flops. It seems like where that leaves Jim is to go over to folks at Disney. And so I was wondering, now that we're at the end of his life and the end of his career, and we're moving towards what I think should be the end of our presentation. Yeah, it's time to end this presentation. Can we talk a little bit? We're over already. But let's talk just a little bit. How does Jim end up at Disney, and what's he supposed to be doing for Disney?
Do you want to take it?
I'll take at least part of it. So Disney was kind of at a rough spot, too.
Yeah.
So something interesting about Disney is their archives have always been good. Something that I do research on is a lot of the major film studios, they didn't care about a film after it was first released. There wasn't home video. There's three networks and maybe a couple, you know, local-only channels that are your markets for movies. But, you know, 90% of the movies that you make aren't ever going to be shown again after their initial release, or at least a couple years after.